Hello, I'm Donovan Bigelow again, and this is part two of my lecture set on the Oedipus complex. We will be covering the material from the several articles, the first five lectures on psychoanalysis by Freud in 1910. In that, he again reiterates his understanding of the overall developmental trajectory, describes infantile childhood sexuality. I don't think I need to go over that again. Reiterates that, quote, "the complex which is thus formed is doomed to early repression, but it continues to exercise a great and lasting influence from the unconscious. It is to be suspected that together with its extensions, it constitutes the nuclear complex of every neurosis, and we may expect to find it no less actively at work in other regions of mental life." He's no big innovation here, just a solid summary. But then he adds something that I think is absolutely profound. "During the time when the child is dominated by the still unrepressed nuclear complex, early childhood, before age five, an important part of his intellectual activity is brought into service of his sexual interests. He begins to inquire where babies come from, and on the basis of the evidence presented to him, guesses more of the true facts than the grown-ups imagine." I love this part. I have said for years that all children know dramatically more than their parents suspect they know. They know more about sexuality than the parents are willing to admit they know. This is an example of parents being in denial about sexual issues. Freud was onto this literally 110 years ago. "His interest in these researches is usually set going by the very real threat offered to him by the arrival of a new baby, which to begin with he regards merely as a competitor. Under the influence of the component instincts that are active in himself, he arrives at a number of infantile sexual theories, such as attributing a male genital organ to both sexes alike, and supposing that babies are conceived by eating and born through the end of the bowel, or regarding sexual intercourse as a hostile act, a kind of violent subjugation." So he's describing several of the earlier sexual theories of children, which I think most people know is true, that kids come up with the wildest ideas about what sexuality means when they hear things, when they get told things, when they see things. It's rather astonishing. And Freud, I think, very accurately lays out some of the ways children come to think about sexuality. It may sometimes be close to the truth, but it very often isn't even close at all. But here's the point here, that their ability to learn is inherently tied to the parental response to their early curiosity about sexuality and the body. Their first curiosity is a sexual curiosity, a sexualized curiosity. They want to know stuff. They want to see about the mother's body. Babies will look and put their mouths on things and grasp and hold, and you can see with the furrowed brow of a very young child that they're working on figuring stuff out. And very often what they're trying to figure out are the early embodied components of their psychosexual development. A parent's reaction to the child's sexualized explorations will have a profound, determinative effect on their ability to academically, intellectually, cognitively learn anything later. Learning in its prototype is the result of sexual curiosity. A harshly punished sexual curiosity on the part of a child, punishment on the part of a mother or a father who says no to that sort of thing, who doesn't with some caution and care and kindness divert the child's interest in an appropriate way. A child who equates parental punishment, parental abandonment, parental rejection with their first initial exercises in curious exploration around sexuality will associate learning with punishment, will associate learning with anxiety. And I think what Freud is suggesting here is that there is no such thing as a learning disorder in and of itself as an independent entity, that all learning disorders are anxiety disorders, around the question of the earliest experience that the child has in the parental response to its sexual curiosity. If the parents respond harshly, critically, cruelly to that curiosity about their own bodies, what's a parental response when the child, when the infant after 18 months old, boy and girl babies, 18 months old and beyond, begin activity that is unmistakably masturbatory? What does a parent, a mother or a father, do when they find a 3-year-old, a 2.5-year-old masturbating? Do they respond calmly? Do they respond with kindness and perhaps distraction in a loving, gentle way? Or do they proceed harshly, demandingly, critically? If they do the latter, they are setting up a learning disorder subsequently if every learning opportunity evokes that kind of parental abandonment or parental punishment. There is a direct correlation here between the psychosexual development, the part of the Oedipal resolution process, and subsequent ability to learn anything at all. I think this is absolutely powerful. He adds here a bit of an addition to the adolescent development. Quote, "The detachment of the child from his parents is thus a task that cannot be evaded if the young individual's social fitness is not to be endangered. During the time at which repression is making its selection among the component instincts, and later, when there should be a slackening of the parent's influence, which is essentially responsible for the expenditure of energy on these repressions, the task of education meets with great problems, which at the present time are certainly not always dealt with in an understanding and unobjectionable manner." So he's tying here, I think if I read this correctly, and it is complicated, he's tying together the early sexual researches of the child, the parental response to those, the setting up of learning disabilities effectively, but in addition, making more complicated the adolescent's push toward autonomy. Our failure as a culture to provide an atmosphere of appropriate Oedipal development also appears to be an explanatory factor in the increasingly late development of adolescence. We now have men and women in their 20s and early 30s still living at home as a dynamic that's becoming more and more common. This isn't an accident. The Oedipus complex, the resolution of it and its final repression in adolescence, is the gateway to adult responsibility, to maturity, again, to this ability to engage in reality in an effective, adaptive way. Take that away, and children can't seem to grow up. It's astonishing how these things, to Freud, were absolutely conjoined, two sides of the same coin. We now, today, are seeing the effects of what looked like, what would have looked to Freud like Oedipal development derailment, in that our adolescents seem incapable of growing up and taking adult responsibility, and yet we are incapable of recognizing our own participation in that derailment. Somehow we always seem to blame the children. I think Freud would suggest that is a problem. Okay. The next treatment is a special type of choice of object made by men. Also published in 1910. I bring this one up, it's a little bit different. He doesn't do a case study, he does a type study. He noticed in his work with men and women that there seems to be a fairly consistent pattern for one type of person. Now, he's not saying that this type is universal, he's not saying everyone does this, but he recognized that this was a common enough type that he thought it would be useful to write down the attributes of it, describe them, discuss them, and see what could be made of them. All right. He describes it as a neurotic type of loving with several odd preconditions that seem very common but unintelligible initially. All right. He describes four attributes of certain men and the way they approach women in a very particular way, in a way he sees over and over. There must be an injured third party, meaning the woman he is attracted to is not available, that she is in another relationship. And so there's this element of taking her away from somebody else that is central to her attractiveness. Right? Second part, that she appears to be a bit of a fallen woman, that, in his Freud's word, he called it love of a prostitute or a prostitute-like woman. That if she's chaste, if she's whole, if she's virtuous, then this type of man would not be attracted to her. He is attracted to a type who's got a history. The third element is that he is obsessive about it. And obsessive about it to the point where he will repeat this pattern over and over and over in what can't be described other than as an obsessive pattern. He will not be satisfied with one, it won't work out, and he will go find another very similar to this. I think everybody sees this at some level or another. Men and women will find a type, and then, especially if that type isn't particularly good for them, they've internalized some bad objects. It's astonishing, it's disheartening, it's frustrating when a friend sees someone in a bad relationship, get out of that, and fall right back into the same type of relationship again. It's common, sadly. He's commenting it here on exactly that sort of thing here. The fourth element of this is a rescue fantasy. Now, there's enough guys out there with rescue fantasies. I don't think this shouldn't surprise anybody. But you tie all of these together. You tie these four attributes together. That there's an injured third party. Love for a fallen woman. The importance of jealousy here. That there's something about the man being jealous of that third party. That it's an essential attribute of this kind of relationship. The obsessiveness of it. And the rescue fantasy. Freud ties it all together nicely. It looks like all four of these things seem kind of random. He ties them together as the maternal prototype of object choice. Who is the injured third party? Well, the father, obviously. The fallen woman? Children at a very young age realize their parents are in some kind of sexual relationship. And so, when the young boy realizes that that sort of thing is common out there, he equates what his mother's doing to what fallen women have done. And because his fantasy is of an absolute meeting of his most primal needs, he can never be satisfied. That there's no way to fix this problem given the woman he's with who cannot meet his more primitive needs that weren't met and could not be met in the maternal situation, but they have not been resolved appropriately, and they remain and retain, therefore, the power of the earliest Oedipal desires. And so you end up with this obsessive focus on relationships that seem doomed to fail and yet are repeated over and over in almost identical particulars. And finally, of course, the rescue fantasy. The son is going to save the mother because she gave him life. And he has to do something equivalent to meet his obligations. And what else could there be to giving life than to rescuing from some dire circumstance? So we have here what he says. We have learned, using a bit of old language, we have learnt from psychoanalysis in other examples that the notion of something irreplaceable, when it is attractive in the unconscious, frequently appears as broken up into an endless series, endless for a reason that every surrogate nevertheless fails to provide the desired satisfaction. And it's the mother surrogate that is being recreated with these fantasies. This explains a lot of people's behavior, it seems to me. It is in 1910, in this article, that he first lays out the phrase, the Oedipus complex. This is the first time in writing that actual term appears. I thought that would be interesting. And at the end, he does recognize the bigger picture. He says, quote, "I do not feel it is necessary for me to justify my method of work on this subject. So here, too, I have, in the first place, aimed at singling out from the observational material extreme and sharply defined types. In both cases, we find a far greater number of individuals in whom only a few features of the type can be recognized, and only features which are not distinctly marked. And it is obvious that a proper appreciation of these types will not be possible until the whole context to which they belong has been explored. I wish he had been clearer here. What he's saying here, at least what he seems to be saying, in no uncertain terms, and he's not claiming some absolute formulation. He's noticing a type, and he's admitting that it shines a small light on one element of a type of relational dynamic. He's saying we cannot generalize from individual cases very well. We have to stay open and stay broad-minded about other possible directions, other possible variations. He does this over and over, and I want to highlight it because the criticism I have read of Freud is often that he is dogmatic. I see nothing of dogmatism in any of these writings. He is, if anything, humbly minimizing claims of truth or a global explanation of human connectedness. He does say that this is profoundly important to the Oedipus complex, largely seen. That he does. I'll give you that. But he repeatedly stays open to the possibilities that within that big picture, there is almost an endless variety of possible avenues through which Oedipal resolution can happen. So I think maybe that's a subtle distinction, maybe it isn't, but I think it's important that I make it. Okay, we take a small leap now to the introductory lectures on psychoanalysis, 1916 and 1917. And starting now, I'm seeing a trend in his writing. After Freud, the two most important thinkers were Freud's daughter, Anna, who dominated the ego psychology school, and Melanie Klein, who dominated the object relations school. And those two have, for 50, 60 years, pretty much dominated the world of psychoanalytic thinking. A few variations on a theme, but those are the two major categories in psychoanalysis. Many thinkers have come after, and they often portray some new language that's supposed to represent something new. Melanie Klein is credited with this idea of what she described as the epistemophilic instincts, instincts toward knowledge. She laid out what she thought was an additional instinct to Freud's dual instinct theory. Freud had sexuality and aggression, the dual instinct theory, and Klein comes up with this addition, epistemophilic, epistemology, the study of the acquisition of knowledge. Okay. I could buy that. And I discovered, as I read this, page 328, under Freud's general theory of the neuroses, introductory lectures on psychoanalysis, 1916, 1917, he says, for instance, the instinct for mastery and the scopophilic and epistemophilic instincts, blah, 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 uses the same phrase that Klein subsequently uses, which I think her co-workers and subsequent thinkers ascribe to her. Not true. Freud had the idea first. And I see over and over as I study this material, either the exact language Freud's use being appropriated later and claimed to be an innovation, or minor changes of tone or language that reflect something identical to what Freud said and yet are claimed to be, again, an innovation. It happened often enough in this material that I couldn't help but point it out. Fascinating. Okay. We call the mother the first love object. He repeats himself here a little bit, goes back to the Oedipus story, adds a little bit about his analysis of the dialogue that Oedipus and Jocasta has, and then does add one significant bit, page 331. When describing the audience reactions to Sophocles' play, he has a slightly different spin on the audience reactions, and it's worth quoting. He says, "It is not to it that the auditor reacts, but to the secret sense and content of the legend. He reacts as though by self-analysis he has recognized the Oedipus complex in himself and had unveiled the will of the gods and the oracle as exalted disguises of his own unconsciousness. It is as though he was obliged to remember the two wishes, to do away with his father and to place in place of him, and to take his mother to wife, and to be horrified at them. And he understands the dramatist's voice as though it were saying to him, you are struggling in vain against your responsibility, and protesting in vain of what you have done in opposition to these criminal intentions. You are guilty, for you have not been able to destroy them. They still persist in you, unconsciously. And there is psychological truth contained in this. There can be no doubt that the Oedipus complex may be looked upon as one of the most important sources of the sense of guilt by which neurotics are so often tormented. And here's the innovation. But more than this, in a study of the beginnings of human religion and morality, which I published in 1913 under the title of Totem and Taboo, I put forward the suggestion that mankind as a whole may have acquired its sense of guilt, the ultimate source of religion and morality, at the beginning of its history in connection with the Oedipus complex. Now, he is putting two things together here that I don't think anybody else has put together like this. The idea that it is a developmental achievement to feel guilt in the context of a relational dynamic to the baby who is in a delusional oneness with the mother, a symbiotic relationship. Splitting occurs. If there is the good and nurturing breast, and then there's stomach aches and pain and suffering, there must be a persecutory bad breast. The breast is split into all good and all bad. It's not real. It's in fantasy, and yet it remains for a baby a developmental achievement to be able to make sense of their little world such. But the mother and baby are not psychologically, emotionally differentiated. To differentiate means to see the self as whole, to see the other as whole, and transfer the punishing of the bad breast onto the whole mother, which generates guilt because now we see the mother that we fantasized about punishing is in fact the mother we love so much. And oh my goodness, I feel guilty about that in fantasy. But this is a noble, this is a developmental achievement. This is healthy to feel guilty about hurting someone who is important to us. Is it not the very height of maturity to apologize when you have offended? Is it not a sign of mature functioning? Isn't it necessary in healthy relationships to be able to accept that you've transgressed, that you've hurt someone's feelings, to take responsibility for that, to make it right with promises of better behavior and diligent efforts to resolve the difficulty? It appears that Freud would say, of course, yes to all of that, but he adds that the existence of guilt, a developmental achievement only capable of existence after the successful resolution of the Oedipus complex, is also the source of so much of our morality, so much of our religious, theological belief systems. How do we process that guilt? How do we think about it? How do we fantasize an agency in front of whom we are guilty? And he is suggesting here directly that there is much in our theological lives, much in what he recognizes are the highest of human achievements that have their source in the resolution of this Oedipus complex. And here again we have, and this may be one of the most critical things to understand in terms of our current social situation, we now are regressing to a kind of splitting. We almost never see in the dialogue in the public sphere anything resembling a dialogue where positions are taken and the opposition positions are thought about, contemplated, the benefit of the doubt is granted. What we have is a primitive kind of splitting. I contain all the right and all the righteousness. The enemy is the enemy. They are different. They are wrong. They are evil. We get to do whatever we want to them because they're the bad guys. And it doesn't matter who they are, whether it's Democrats and Republicans, Christians and Muslims, Jews and everybody else. We see this primitive, this growing primitive inability to carry on any political dialogue. I'm reminded of TV shows I saw in the 60s when I was very young and couldn't possibly understand what they were. William F. Buckley had a TV show called Firing Line. And I remember it. I remember thinking, well, this I don't really understand what they're saying, but the atmosphere was fascinating. He would bring on people he disagreed with. And he would disagree with them strongly. And he would take his position. The other side would take their position. He would consider elements of it. He would attempt clarification. They would refute and maybe refute his position. He would acknowledge that their position seemed reasonable given the premises, and they would go back and forth in this elegant, honorable, almost noble give and take. I haven't seen that in 30 years. It seems to me that that's an element, a symptom of this inability to reach a healthy, independent separateness from the parents. It is as if we remain childlike in our splitting tendencies and that we do not see the other as a whole person. The problem is we don't see ourselves as a whole person. We still see ourselves as an entitled child who deserves the full attention of the mother figure, the government, the political party, the religious leader, whoever. I don't want to make too much of this, but Freud's claims for the Oedipal complex, are broad, and he is attempting to show how and why with this material. Okay. What then can be gathered about the Oedipus complex from the direct observation of children at the time of their making their choice of an object before the latency period? So he's going back, and this is in 1916 what he adds to it. He adds ambivalence, that we now no longer have a simple I'm identifying with the mother or the father and in hostile competition to the other. Now it's getting complicated. Observation is often obscured by the circumstance that on other occasions the same child will simultaneously give evidence of great affection for his father, but contrary, or as it is better to say, ambivalent emotional attitudes, which in adults would lead to a conflict, remain compatible with each other for a long time in children, just as later they find a permanent place beside each other in the unconscious. So we've just taken a sophisticated leap. Freud is saying, because he sees it in his patients, it's a clinical fact to him, that simultaneous with all of this hostile, antagonistic conflict and this desire is in both boys and girls a simultaneous ambivalence, that we can hate our father and wish him dead, but we also love him and also need him to protect us. Same thing with the mother. We may, if we're female, desire the father and see the mother as the hated competition, and yet we need the mother, love the mother. That those two things sit side by side. Freud sees it as ambivalence. That doesn't mean, and what he's suggesting is ambivalence is okay. It doesn't have to be resolved. Hate doesn't mean you have to act it out. It means it sits here as a normal function in a human's mind. We get to love and we get to hate. We don't get to act out on it. But this, to me, is a key component of maturity. You can hate without having to throw an ashtray across the room. You can hate without having to act out that hate. You can feel these feelings, but contain them and deal with reality in a way that's adaptive. This is a resolution of the Oedipus complex of the most profound implications for life in the real world. Powerful stuff. All right, even as late as 1916, 1917, he says, as you see, I have only described the relation of a boy to his father and mother. Things happen in just the same way with little girls, with the necessary changes. So he sees that there is a parallelism still between boys and girls, and he assumes it's sort of a mirror image of each other. He adds some more complexity here at the bottom of page 333. When other children appear on the scene, the Oedipus complex is enlarged into a family complex. Aha! We now have a couple of additional layers. Older brothers and sisters, younger brothers and sisters, make the traditional template of the Oedipal resolution much more complicated. Everybody knows that a much older sister will take on elements of the maternal function to the younger siblings. Same thing with an older brother. A younger daughter or son will evoke maternal or paternal responses in the older children. It will compound things. He adds birth order to this in a way that I think is astonishingly ahead of the time. There was a book written, I think, in the 90s about this, the importance of birth order in character development. Well, Freud lays it down in 1916. And he lays out the idea of this. The phrase he uses is a family complex. And describes in the bottom of 334. From this, you will conclude, among other things, that the position of a child in the family order is a factor of extreme importance in determining the shape of his later life and should deserve consideration in every life history. Birth order, right there. All right. He then adds, and I think necessarily so, a treatment of something that I think causes the most difficulty for everyone, and that's the prohibition of incest. Incest just immediately evokes a visceral reaction of repugnance, of hatred, of revulsion. And yet, how did that happen? He actually has a sense of humor, I think, here, if you look at it closely. But what is more important in view of this information, which can be so easily obtained, you will not be able to recall without a smile the pronouncement of science in explanation of the prohibition of incest. There is no end to what has been invented on the subject. It has been said that sexual inclination is diverted from members of the same family, who are of the opposite sex, by the fact of having lived together from childhood. Or again, that a biological purpose of avoiding inbreeding is represented psychically by an innate horror of incest. He's laughing at these things. He's saying this is ridiculous. In all of this, the fact is entirely overlooked that such an inexorable prohibition of it in law and custom would not be needed if there were any reliable natural barriers against the temptation to incest. The truth is just the opposite. A human being's first choice of an object is regularly an incestuous one, aimed, in the case of the male, at his mother and sister, and it calls for the severest prohibitions to deter this persistent infantile tendency from realization. Among the primitive races still living today, among savages, the prohibition against incest are even very much stricter than among ourselves. Okay, and he goes on to explain this, because he was steeped in history quite well. Mythology will teach you that incest, which is supposed to be so much detested by humans, is unhesitatingly allowed to the gods. And you may learn from ancient history that incestuous sister marriage was a sanctified injunction upon the person of the ruler among the Egyptian pharaohs and the Incas of Peru. What was in question was thus a privilege forbidden to the common herd. Mother incest was one of the crimes of Oedipus. Parricide was the other. It may be remarked in passing that they are also the two great crimes proscribed by totemism, the first socio-religious institution of mankind. Whenever someone gives an account of a past event, even if he is a historian, we must take into account what he unintentionally puts back into the past from the present or from some intermediate time, thus falsifying the picture of it. Okay, what he's challenging us here on is our incestuous tendencies are inevitable, are part of our natural earliest developmental beginnings, and we must fight against them rather dramatically and prohibit against them aggressively, otherwise they will run rampant. And the emotional evocation of horror at these things makes looking back on our past suspect. We do not see the past honestly. Our memory is not a video recorder. We will disturb our memories by our own emotional response to the history we are thinking about. He goes back and... Okay. All right, page 23, here we go. He reiterates here in some detail the absolute centrality of adolescence and recapitulates the re-enlivened Oedipal dynamics in desperate need of final resolution in order to achieve any kind of adult sensibility. Okay. Conclusion. Since, however, everyone, and not only neurotics, experience these perverse, incestuous, murderous dreams, we may conclude that people who are normal today have passed along a path of development that has led through the perversions and object cathexis of the Oedipus complex, that is the path of normal development, and that neurotics merely exhibit to us in a magnified and coarsened form what the analysis of dreams reveal to us in healthy people as well. Again, there but for the grace of God go I, that there is not a significant difference between the severely perverse and the so-called normal. It is a matter of degree. It is not a matter of kind. It is a quantitative, not a qualitative difference between the severely disturbed and the us so-called normals. I find that just astonishing. We all must pass through these very often terrifying dynamics. To the extent we can see the truth of them, we can do that. To the extent we blind ourselves to that truth, we remain children, we remain neurotic. Freud makes his, I think, final leap into the mostly the final form of his Oedipus complex material in his great text of 1923, The Ego and the Id. This is the, call it the great divide between the early formulations and the final formulations. And if it has seemed complicated up to now, it gets a lot more complicated. Once I read The Ego and the Id, I forever gave, I gave no credence to anyone who said Freud was dogmatic or simplistic or anything like that. This is an immensely dense text. I think it's one of the hardest bits of psychological writing I've ever attempted, and it is not clear to me I understand it very well yet. I will continue to study it. It will always, I think, provide a well to go back to. And right off the bat, page 31, the effects of the first identifications made in earliest childhood will be general and lasting. This leads us back to the origin of the ego ideal. For behind it, there lies hidden an individual's first and most important identification, his identification with the father in his own personal prehistory. Now, he opens up two things here. He opens up the primary idea of identification, how that becomes the cornerstone of the resolution of the Oedipus complex for both boys and girls. And suggests that we have direct and immediate identification. This is sophisticated. What he's saying is we don't learn about a father's role. We don't think about and take in cognitively the rules father lays down for us. It doesn't have to be explained to us, but he's suggesting a direct and immediate identification. what I think he's saying here, and what is astonishing, given that this is written in 1923, was that just a handful of years ago, mid-1990s through the first decade of the 21st century, we had neurological scanning technology, I think led by Dr. Alan Shore, among others, which suggested a direct, intuitive, right brain to right brain, unconscious emotional resonance, an intuitive projective process, an internalization, identification, pre-linguistic, pre-left brain, rational, language-based, but the internalization of, and what Freud would say, an identification, his explanation of how the infant develops neurologically seems in virtual lockstep with Freud's psychological, psychoanalytic understanding laid down in 1923, that we have a direct and immediate identification in the child with the personality, the emotional dynamic, the mind of the mother and father, in this case, the father. The whole subject, however, is so complicated that it will be necessary to go into it in greater detail. The intricacy of the problem is due to two factors: the triangular character of the Oedipus situation and the constitutional bisexuality of each individual. And we're just opening things up. We have this triangular relationship. This is no longer about a simple one-on-one mother-child connection. The combinations within that triangle are inherently complex. And then he throws in this extra layer of bisexuality. Oh, not quite done yet. He drops a footnote when he says the identification is to the father for the boy. He adds something important here. Perhaps it would be safer to say with the parents, identifying with the parents. For before a child has arrived at definite knowledge of the difference between the sexes, the lack of a penis, it does not distinguish in value between its father and its mother. So we have here what to me is completely omitted from virtually all modern criticism of the Oedipus complex, is that Freud does not narrow the identification of the boy child to the father, but opens up the identification, I think, not just with the father and with individually the mother, but this is where I get with the parents. This is the assumption underneath the idea of the internalized parental object, and not just the individuals, but the quality of their emotional life and the quality of their relationship. This is what's identified with. Not the individuals, certainly, and this is the key, not what they say, not what they do, but who they are at a pre-linguistic level, before language is even formed in the child's mind. We have primary direct identification, right brain to right brain, according to the modern developmental neuroscientists. Freud simply says, with the parents, direct and immediate identification, but it's unmistakably clear that that's what he's talking about. Astonishing, absolutely astonishing. In its simplified form, the case of a male child may be described as follows. At a very early stage, the little boy develops an object cathexis for his mother, that means basically just a relational drive, which originally related to the mother's breast and is the prototype for an object choice on the anacletic model. The proto-relational dependency, that's what anacletic means. The boy deals with his father by identifying himself with him. For a time, these two relationships proceed side by side until the boy's sexual wishes in regard to his mother become more intense and his father is perceived as an obstacle to them. From this, the Oedipus complex originates. Okay, so we've got three or four layers of complexity, but the basic structure remains the same. And its resolution is the same. In this way, the dissolution of the Oedipus complex would consolidate the masculinity in a boy's character. In a precisely analogous way, the outcome of the Oedipus attitude in a little girl may be an intensification of her identification with the mother, or the setting up of such an identification for the first time, a result which will fix the child's feminine character. So still primarily a parallelism between the boy and the girl's Oedipal development. All right. Now, again, more complexity. Top of page 33. It would appear, therefore, that in both sexes, the relative strength of the masculine and feminine sexual dispositions is what determines whether the outcome of the Oedipus situation shall be an identification with the father or with the mother. What does that mean? Two things. First, he's describing the outcome of the Oedipus situation. This is another one of those phrases that has been subsequently attributed to Melanie Klein as a more sophisticated approach than Freud had, but she lifted it apparently from this section of the ego and the superego, section 3 of the ego and the id. What is he saying here? It would therefore appear that in both sexes, the relative strength of the masculine and feminine sexual dispositions is what determines whether the outcome of the Oedipus situation shall be an identification with the father or the mother. So he's discussing here what looks like sexual orientation, gender identity, sexual orientation, homosexuality or heterosexuality. The relative strength of the masculine and feminine sexual dispositions, that feels biological. That suggests a constitutional element to it. All right? The initial suggestion here is that, well, that's biological. Okay? This is one of the ways in which bisexuality takes a hand in the subsequent vicissitudes of the Oedipus complex. The other way is even more important, for one gets an impression that the simple Oedipus complex is by no means its commonest form, but rather represents a simplification or a schematization, which to be sure is often enough justified for practical purposes. Closer study usually discloses the more complete Oedipus complex, which is twofold, positive and negative, and is due to the bisexuality originally present in children. That is to say, a boy has not merely an ambivalent attitude toward his father and an affectionate object choice toward his mother, but at the same time he also behaves like a girl and displays an affectionate feminine attitude to his father and a corresponding jealousy and hostility towards his mother. It is this complicating element introduced by bisexuality that makes it so difficult to obtain a clear view of the facts in connection with the earliest object choices and identifications, and still more difficult to describe them intelligibly. It may even be that the ambivalence displayed in the relation to the parents should be attributed entirely to bisexuality, and that it is not, as I have represented above, developed out of identification in the consequence of rivalry. So he's just opened a can of worms here. What is it? He's throwing open, in the same paragraph, what looks like a possible refutation of a centerpiece of his Oedipal disposition, the identification idea. But wait a minute, it might actually be bisexuality at the biological level and not a developmental achievement. What's more powerful, the relational dynamics of development or the innate predispositions of biology, which causes heterosexual and homosexual orientation to develop? He's throwing it open here. And then says, in my opinion, it is advisable in general, and quite especially where neurotics are concerned, to assume the existence of the complete Oedipus complex. Analytic experience then shows that in a number of cases, one or the other constituents disappears, except for barely distinguishable traces, so that the result is a series from the normal positive Oedipus complex at one end and the inverted negative one at the other. That would be a homosexual object choice. While its intermediate members exhibit the complete form with one or the other of its two components preponderating. At the dissolution of the Oedipus complex, the four trends of which it consists will group themselves in such a way as to produce a father identification and a mother identification. The father identification will preserve the object relation to the mother, which belongs to the positive complex, and will at the same time replace the object relation to the father, which belongs to the inverted complex, and the same will be true mutatis mutandis, which means the necessary changes having been made, of the mother identification. The relative intensity of the two identifications in any individual will reflect the preponderance in him of one or other of the two sexual dispositions. Wow. The first time I read that, I had no idea what it meant. But as I go back and reread and re-listen, what I find is that he has opened up an integration of the genetic and the developmental. And the capstone of this is this: the broad general outcome of the sexual phase dominated by the Oedipus complex may therefore be taken to be the forming of a precipitate in the ego consisting of these two identifications, in some way united with each other. This modification of the ego retains its special position. It confronts the other contents of the ego as an ego ideal or superego. This is it. This is the penultimate Oedipal developmental dynamic, the creation of the superego or ego ideal. And he's suggesting that it is a precipitate of both of the mother identification and the father identifications. The bisexuality of everyone sorts itself out developmentally. The biologically based bisexuality sorts itself out developmentally, and ultimately the developmental achievement of a superego whose function is to internalize the rules of the parents, not just the father, but the parents, provides the structure for relating to others as a whole object. It is the structure that punishes when transgressions of the internalized rules are met. When the ideal is not achieved, we feel guilty. We have a punitive superego, which is its job in some ways. And if it wasn't complicated enough, the superego is, however, not simply a residue of the earliest object choices of the id. It also represents an energetic reaction formation against those choices. Its relation to the ego is not exhausted by the precept, "You ought to be like this, like your father." It also comprises the prohibition, "You may not be like this, like your father." That is, you may not do all that he does. Some things are his prerogative. And I think what that means is you have to grow up. You can identify with the father, grow up emotionally with that superego and that ego ideal that gives you a place to stand autonomous from the parents, and yet having identified with them, can move out into the world having experienced triangular relationships, to be seen, to allow others to have relationships, to have internalized those relationships within you, to be able to imagine being seen by other independent, autonomous creatures, to see that others have relationships that exclude you and allow that to be okay. You can't have everything you want. It isn't all yours. The failure to do that seems to me, among other things, to result in a kind of narcissism or entitlement. Okay. Page 35. One of the biological and the other... Okay. If we consider once more the origin of a superego as we have described it, we shall recognize that it is the outcome of two highly important factors, one of a biological and the other of a historical nature. So we got Freud here doing exactly what the neurological developmental scientists have said, have discovered in the context of their sophisticated neurological scanning technologies. They call it, in the modern era, epigenetics, the interweaving of biological and developmental dynamics, that you need love to evoke the genetic possibilities of neurological development. And the more your neurological development proceeds, the more able you are to be in relationships in a healthy way, and there's this symbiotic intertwining of genetics and environment. That is exactly what Freud is saying in 1923 on page 35 of this. Astonishing, absolutely astonishing. Okay. Psychoanalysis. Psychoanalysis has been reproached time after time with ignoring the higher moral, suprapersonal side of human nature. And this is where he says no. This is where he says it comes from. Okay? All right, these next three pages are absolutely central. The ego ideal is therefore the heir of the Oedipus complex, and thus it is also the expression of the most powerful impulses and the most important libidinal vicissitudes of the id. By setting up this ego ideal, the ego has mastered the Oedipus complex and at the same time placed itself in subjection to the id. Okay. Owing to the way in which the ego ideal is formed, it has the most abundant links with the phylogenic acquisition of each individual. What he's saying with this complicated, seemingly archaic language, again, is the integration of our biology and our environment. And I think this next paragraph is the most important and puts a capstone on why he, in that first paragraph I read, assumes the Oedipus complex is the nuclear complex around which everything else rotates. It is easy to show that the ego ideal answers to everything that is expected of the higher nature of man. Blah, blah, blah. The tension between the demands of conscience and the actual performances of the ego is experienced as a sense of guilt. Here it is. Social feelings rest on identifications with other people on the basis of having the same ego ideal. In this one sentence, he puts a capstone on the necessity of maturity in this way as the necessary prerequisite for a link to cultural achievement, to identification with others in the community. That without this capstone of Oedipal development, we remain fragmented individuals if we do not identify with each other. Fundamentally, we fragment into hostile groups. Does this sound familiar? This is what's happening now, that a nation, a culture, a civilization can only stay together as long as there is a mutual identification about their identity that is similar. We, for the longest time, self-identified with this culture as American. There have actually been a couple news reports lately that the word American is now no longer sensitive enough, that it makes some people uncomfortable. I think that's a symptom of civilizational collapse. I think Freud put his finger on it right here, page 37 of this text. Social feelings rest on identifications with other people on the basis of having the same ego ideal. Not in terms of learning, not in terms of common experience, but in terms of a much more primitive common developmental dynamic wherein we internalize similar structure. If we assimilate, if everyone's different, if no one is in agreement anymore about what it means to be an American, if we have begun worshiping at the altar of diversity and multiculturalism, we doom the civilization to fragmentation. The conclusion here, the shocking, terrifying conclusion, is that diversity and multiculturalism are not an ethical, moral set of premises, that they are mental illnesses. They are derivatives of mental illness. They are symptoms of a civilizational collapse and a catastrophic failure of developmentally appropriate movement through the Oedipus complex. This is shocking. This is almost unbelievable. This is why Freud has come under such criticism, because this is the inevitable conclusion of any deep understanding of the Oedipus complex and its meaning. It is in this way an absolute and direct and immediate challenge to what appear to be the growing consensus in our civilization about what is good and right and true and fair and just. And yet it appears that his accusation is that those things that so many people hold so dearly are really a function of derailed Oedipal development. It is astonishing, and it pleads for more study. It pleads to look, to see, to follow the Oedipal lesson, to find the truth, though the heavens fall. To find the truth of human development, of the necessities of human development, even at the risk of contradicting our most cherished values. Oedipus had the courage of his convictions. Freud, following Oedipus, explored the human mind in whatever direction his clinical researches took him. He endured decades of vicious criticism, and he always felt that his science was more important than acquiescing to anyone else's ideology. I think ultimately that is his request. Do not allow ideology, which is nothing more than the defensive denial of reality, to cloud the achievements of hard-won science. He is arguing for the legitimacy of scientific evidence. He does not want to see symptoms being facilitated as truth in the face of scientific evidence to the contrary. Now, this gets complicated in that we have now a postmodern attack on the very idea of truth beyond the scope of this lecture, clearly. And yet I want to argue that what he is saying in with the reality principle is that there is always an external reality that will win, that we are not entirely subjective creatures, that there is an external reality we must bow to, and our philosophy notwithstanding, we must adapt to, and mental illness is a refusal, inability, or lack of strength to do that very thing. He put the Oedipus complex at the center of his thinking about human nature and civilization, because to him it represented the achievement of sufficient strength to deal with reality, to deal with love, to deal with our children, and to facilitate their growth and development into healthy, autonomous creatures who could carry on a tradition that he thought was worthy of some protection. So I think I will draw it to a close now. I want to reiterate in closing Caper and Bion's idea of truth. I think ultimately that's what he's getting at. And this may be where most modern criticism is ultimately based. Do you believe that there exists some reasonably identifiable reality? Not do we have any insight into absolute truth. That's not what Freud's saying. Can we reasonably identify reality sufficient to make choices about how to get through our day and make adaptive decisions to reality? Do we have enough mental health within us? And do parents have enough emotional strength to be able to provide the containment for a child's emotional development, which is a necessity to manage the intense feelings, eruptions of emotional conflict around Oedipal development? If we don't have that, we must get it, or we are derailing our children. This is summarized by the phrase, the intergenerational transmission of trauma. If we aren't right, our children will not be right. And on down it goes, that in intergenerational transmission of trauma. Freud is offering us the opportunity to say no to that, to do something different than what was just handed down to us, to potentially be better than our parents were. Other conclusions, that this idea of guilt as not a bad thing, that perhaps feeling guilty is actually a developmental achievement. We call people who don't feel any guilt about the damage they do sociopaths for a reason. That it's an emotional response that ought to get us to look inside ourselves, not just avoid. It doesn't just evoke depression and a sense of our own badness. It's a signal to evaluate what we're doing and why. We should pay attention to it. Perhaps as a final word, it also suggests that mourning, grieving a loss, is absolutely essential to the resolution of the Oedipus complex. To be able to mourn is a necessity of development, that every phase we go through must involve the ability to mourn the loss of what was given up in order to move forward. Mourning is a necessity for growth. Only the strength achieved in the resolution of the Oedipus complex allows that strength to continue. Only the strength generated by the resolution of the Oedipus complex will allow healthy relationships to be achieved in the real world with real whole objects. The ability to bear these things, and I think this is the existential connection to Freud. We struggle with guilt, we struggle to endure sadness, we struggle with life's difficulties, and that, I think, is the tragedy of Oedipus. We cannot psychically resolve these things in some final way. To attempt to do so is an illusion, is a delusion. There is no perfect mother and father that can resolve all of our desires. We cannot win the Oedipal struggle. We have to lose the Oedipal struggle. We have to resolve it internally to move forward to be able to live in the real world. Bearing guilt, bearing the mourning, bearing the difficulties of life's, as Freud said, vicissitudes, is the stamp of Oedipal success. It is our burden that we must carry into and through our lives. And I think the final thing is, it's a burden we must continue to carry, because in every new event in our life, in every new relationship, the Oedipal internalized complex relational dynamics must be reworked. We never get beyond the Oedipus dynamic. It is our work to continue to mature, to deepen our awareness. But it is worked and reworked throughout our lives. It is a burden we must carry to be mature. And it almost provides a sense of relief. We don't have to be perfect. We don't have to achieve some sense of absolute peace or freedom. Knowing that it's a burden we must continue to carry that we must only be human in this way. We only need to be good enough. We need not be perfect nor strive for perfection, is the relief that accepting the Oedipus complex and its derivatives allows us. And I don't think this is a small thing. I think this is a huge thing. This is, I believe, why Freud thought it was so important. It relieves us of the burden of an ideal that we cannot meet. It relieves us of the burden of perfection and allows us to carry the burden of living with some joy and some hope. If we can do that, Freud would suggest that that is enough. To me, it seems like plenty. Good luck with that. Thank you. Let me add, after saying good luck with that, let me add one piece. And I think it's necessary, and I apologize for adding this as an afterthought. It should have been in the body of the material. Freud has been attacked more viciously for the idea of penis envy than for anything else, and I have to address that. I think what he meant was not a direct envy of the organ of the penis. He meant it as a metaphor for the power that men had back in the day, and I think there's ample evidence that he was right about that. It was not the actual organ that they wanted or envied, it was the meaning of that as a metaphor and as a social construct. I am familiar with a joke and with a cartoon that I want to relate that I think resolves this whole problem of penis envy. Here's the joke, told to me by a very dear friend of mine who's not a psychologist. Little boy, little girl, playing in the sandbox in the lot between their two respective houses. And as little boys and girls are wont to do, they start bragging about the things that they have or their parents have. And the little boy says, well, my daddy's got this fancy boat. And my little girl says, well, my mommy's got this fancy car. And they go back and forth several times. And the little boy finally runs out of things to brag about and drops his pants and says to the little girl, I've got one of these and you don't. And the little girl drops her pants, looks down, and she doesn't have one. And she goes crying back home. 5 minutes later, she comes walking back down the sidewalk, and she is looking pretty full of herself. And the little boy suspiciously looks at her and says, what? And the little girl looks at him and says, well, my mommy says with one of these, I can get all of those I want. And I laughed when I first heard that because it was so true. It was so very true. So much for penis envy. And the other joke I heard, and I don't know if you'll be able to see this or not, but here it is, a picture of a little girl and a little boy standing next to each other, and they're naked except for their little panties, and the girl has got her panties being held open, and the little boy is looking in them, and the balloon above it says, with this, I'm going to control your life. So true, so hilariously true, and so much for penis envy. Finally, my sense is that penis envy doesn't exist anymore because it has been so successful. Remember, here's the dangerous part. Envy is a destructive emotion. The difference between jealousy and envy is central. Jealousy means I want something someone else has. Envy means because of what they have, reminds me that I don't have it, and I am shamed by that. I don't want what they have. I want to destroy what they have. And my sense is we don't see much of penis envy anymore because over the last 50 years, the power of the phallus, as Freud would say, has in fact been destroyed. Penis envy has worked. The rise of the feminist movement and the fall of virtually everything associated with traditional masculine identity has resulted in the emotional castration of men to the point where there's nothing left or very little left to, in fact, envy. And it is not clear to me that that has been a developmental advantage socially. I challenge that a little. I think there's still plenty of virile, traditional men around, and to that extent, there may still be examples of penis envy. But my sense is now women have co-opted the power represented by the phallus to the point where you find men now castrated emotionally. We have, I saw a while back on the internet this idea of pajama boy, this grown man in his 20s in a onesie, a bright red one. It looked hideous to me. We have this example of grown men still living with their parents in their 20s and 30s. We have emasculation of men across the board and the empowerment of women. I'm not opposed to the empowerment of women. I think it's a good thing. But it seems to me that the castration of the American male is a grave threat given the rise of other nations and other powers. We require protection by men who are capable of the use, the appropriate use of force. To the extent we are taking that away from our young men, it may cost us more than it's giving us. These are sociological questions beyond the scope of this lecture, but I wanted to add a footnote. I do not think penis envy, as Freud laid it down, was what it has been interpreted to be in the modern era, and in any case, I no longer think it's particularly relevant under these circumstances. Castration anxiety, what Freud said was the center of how the Oedipus complex is resolved in men may yet be a central figure, a central factor in the modern society, but not in a good way. We'll see. Thank you. That's all.